So, welcome to Fucked Up Fables. If ruining your childhood is something you enjoy, you've come to the right place. Today, Enkidu is giving us some love stories from ancient Greece. There is a lot to choose from, so what are we talking about today?
So, if people remember from last week, I said that I had an episode picked out, and it was a 3-for-1, right? But then I panicked earlier this week because I thought that I was going to have to do 2 love stories in February because I can't do math and forgot that we took a week off. So I panicked, wrote a whole other script, and I realized today that I only need to do 1, but I can't decide between the 2 now. So I'm going to make you decide. So Titania has no idea what the other one I wrote up was. So all I'm going to give you is the name of the Google Doc title. Which, I know you haven't seen all of my titles, but we can, I think you know me well enough to know that none of them are, other than King Arthur and Dionysus Upcoming, none of them are actually titled with what they are, i.e. Shiny Boy is what I titled my Boulder episode. So, the, with no context whatsoever, they are both Greek love stories, and they are both multiple stories in one. So, we have either soulmates, or all is fair in love and war.
Soulmates isn't pulling from Pluto, is it?
We're Greek, not Roman.
I mix them up all the time. Okay.
You have no idea what the second group of stories is. I'm not going to tell you.
I don't remember the first one. I'm going completely blind into this. Soulmates, or what was the other one?
All is fair in love and war.
I gotta go with that one.
All is fair in love
and
war.
Sounds revengeful.
So, all is fair in love and war is what I was originally gonna do. And no, none of them involve Hades. I can't say they don't involve Persephone, because Persephone is involved in a story in the other one. But don't worry, we'll get to those other ones at another time. But I'm kind of sad you didn't pick that one. I was really hoping you were gonna pick Soulmates. I worked really hard on that one for
sorry.
A whole day.
I'm sorry.
All right, so we are doing All is Fair in Love and War. So let me,
So you picked All is Fair in Love and War, which I'm sorry to say has absolutely nothing to do with Aries and absolutely nothing to do with Aphrodite.
I'm just hoping it involved a lot of, like, fighting.
Yeah, you could say that, actually. As a reminder for those who don't remember, like Titania, so I'm going to cover 3 stories today. They are 3 pretty famous Greek stories that all center around love. And following along the lines of Pandora's Box, they're ones that you probably recognize the name, but don't really know the whole story. Or, like, think you know the story, but really, you know, like, a little snippet of it. So those 3 stories are Oedipus, Orpheus, and Narcissus.
Oh, I remember now.
Yes. I'm really sad that you didn't do my other one, because my other one was all about gods. It was all
I
about-
mean, I chose the other, the soulmate, right? All I could think of Plato's theory for soulmates, and I couldn't get that out of my head, which is why I went the other way.
Yeah, I chose soulmates because it's a very, soulmate.
It's probably very Hancock, right?
Well, so there are some that are very, like, legit, follow, like, the soulmate kind of scheme. And then there are some that are just creepy. And then there's one with Zeus.
Let's not get into Zeus. Wait, actually, the phrase is, let's not let Zeus get into us.
Yeah. So, for today's episode, content warning. Extra super one, like, out of all the content warnings I've ever done so far, this is, like, gonna be the biggest one that people need to pay attention to. So, content warning for incest, patricide, rape, death, and suicide. And then I will also mention this when we get there, but, like, extra special emphasis on the suicide. So there are multiple suicides that happen in these 3 stories, but there's one in particular in the story of Narcissus that involves the suicide of a gay character who kills himself because he is in love with another man. And so it's, like, But I can't gloss over that because it is very important to the actual story. So I will remind you again when that one comes up, but if that bothers you, do not listen to Narcissus. Just Google Narcissus, you'll be good to go.
Question. Actually, if you don't want to watch Narcissus, I can give you my childhood memory of the story of Narcissus. Once there was a god and his name was Narcissus, and he was so very beautiful, and one day he caught his reflection in the lake that he was walking by, and he saw how beautiful he was, and he bent over and he just kept staring at it, and he could not walk away until eventually he turned into a flower that we now know as Narcissus.
The only part of that that you got right was that he saw his own reflection and fell in love.
So, like I said, this is from a grade school book. Also, that's the story for all people who want to still hear Narcissus, but trigger warning has pushed them away. So I'm just saying, that's the story that those people can walk away with.
I'll accept it. So, because this is me and I do mythology and I know you and I know that you love to learn this stuff, we're going to kind of deep dive into some of the weird topics we're going to talk about. So first up is the story of Oedipus. So I think most people know him as the dude who fell in love with his mother and had sex with her and then killed his father.
Also, is there an Oedipus Rex?
So we will get to that.
Okay.
So you can thank Freud for all of this, and he's the one who actually coined the term Oedipus complex. So according to Freud, there is the Oedipus complex, which is a young boy's sexual love of a parent and a hatred of the other. So this is, I'm not going so deep into this, but it comes in a negative and a positive. It doesn't mean good or bad, it's just the way that they refer to the different types. So positive would be a boy who is in love with his mother but hates his father. Negative would be the opposite. So it's a boy in love with his father but hates his mother. So it can happen either way. And then the Electra complex is the same exact thing, except it's a girl. So the positive would be the girl in love with her father hates the mother. Negative would be the girl in love with her mother hates her father. So that's like the distinction. And the difference between positive and negative. Again, it's not a good or a bad, it's just Freud. That's as far as I'm going to go because I don't care for Freud. Anyways. So, like you said, Oedipus Rex is another name that people might know. Also, Oedipus Tyrannus. And this is because there was actually a series of three plays based on the story of Oedipus by Sophocles. But in the actual myth, he is just referred to as Oedipus. So that's where Oedipus Rex, which comes from Oedipus Tyrannus, because Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Was he a king in the play? Because Rex is
a
king.
We'll get there.
Oh, okay. All right. Spoils. Spoiler. Spoils.
we'll get there. We'll see. So, Oedipus is a tragic hero, and everyone knows that tragic heroes have a soft place in my heart. So what makes a tragic hero in Greek mythology is their tragic flaw or their harmatia, which I kind of talked about in Hercules, but we're kind of going to go over a little bit again now. So a harmatia is their strength that also is a weakness that typically leads to their death, such as Achilles and his heel. Yes, I will eventually tell the stories of Achilles. Bear with me. It's intense.
Is Troy accurate?
What?
Is the movie Troy accurate?
No. Moving on. No. I will say about the most accurate thing in that movie is Orlando Bloom playing Paris. Because, yeah.
Orlando's my man. Oh, you thought I defended Gerard Butler a lot last time. We can start getting into Orlando Bloom.
Oh. I love Orlando Bloom when he has his clothes on, but there's that scene in Troy where he takes his shirt off, and I was like, no, I'm good. But that is actually, like, how Paris looks. Like, he is not a strong, like, he has no muscle. He's just a dude. Like, so it was pretty.
Find it.
I couldn't do it. Anyways, I was more of a Brad Pitt as Achilles fan, even though I don't like him as Achilles, but that's neither here nor there. We're not talking about Troy today. We're talking about Oedipus.
All right, Oedipus.
So Oedipus does have a tragic flaw, but it's not the same way that, like, the other tragic heroes have a tragic flaw, because the flaw that is given to Oedipus is actually a strength for several other heroes, such as Hercules and Odysseus. So it makes it, in my opinion, even more tragic, because it shouldn't be a flaw, but in the case of Oedipus, it's his flaw. And his flaw is his determination. And there are a couple of theories on this flaw, which brings up the question of, does harmatia actually mean flaw or not? And a lot of people believe that it's the term for someone who misses the mark. So it's a hero who sets out to achieve something and falls short of it and finds something else entirely. So,
it's like an ambition. Like, determination could also be ambition. And ambition can be seen as great, because you could be, you know, you'd be ambitious to go get a college degree and go get an awesome job as a lawyer and become a partner someday. But you can also be ambitious in the way that fucking Ted Cruz is ambitious, to where, you know, just destroy everyone around you and the own people that vote for you for your own gain. So
we're not talking about the Zodiac Killer on this podcast, okay?
That ambition is like a two-sided coin. There's a line that you can cross that then makes it a flaw.
Yes, but I'll let you all make your decision on if you think it's actually a flaw or if it's more along the lines of someone who just kind of missed the mark. Like, they reached for it and didn't quite get there. King, okay, I apologize for these names because we're Greek names that have an S. Okay, so specifically Greek names that end with an S throw me off every time. If it ends in an E, I got it. If it ends in an S, see ya. So, King Laius? We're gonna go with Laius. So, King Laius and Queen Jocasta were preparing to have a child. So, King Laius receives word that the Oracle of Delphi, who is the, you know, prophet of Apollo, is looking for him, and she has a prophecy regarding this birth. So, he's like, fuck yeah, I'm gonna go meet her. So, he travels to Delphi. So, because she's a mouthpiece of Apollo, her words are literally God, so what she says will come to pass. Like, it's kind of like the fates in a way. Like, you can't change the fates' design. When the oracle says something, that's what happens. So the oracle tells King Laius that his son will grow up to not only kill him, but then marry his wife. So, like, right off the bat, here we go. So Laius believes...
And that's where Freud stopped.
Yeah, Oedipus the end. All right, next one. So Laius believes that he can stop this prophecy, which we all know that he can't. So he returns home and summons a shepherd. And when the child is born, he tells the shepherd that he needs to take it to the forest and leave it for the animals to eat, which solves all of his problems. And as far as King Laius and Queen Jocasta know, it does. But the shepherd cannot bring himself to abandon the child. So he finds another shepherd to take the baby. So he's like, hey, dude, I have a baby that I need you to take so that it doesn't look suspicious when I suddenly have a kid. So that goes. So this new shepherd travels to the kingdom of King Polybus and Queen Merope and leaves a child with them. So the king and queen raise the boy, and his name is Oedipus. So Oedipus grows up, and he encounters the Oracle of Delphi himself, and he hears this prophecy that was foretold back when before he was born, that he's going to kill his father and marry his mother. So he is horrified, as any normal sane person should be, that this is what's going to happen. So he leaves his family and home and heads for Thebes, because he's planning to get as far away from his parents as possible, because if they're not around, then he can't kill his father, he can't marry his mother, okay? So, on the way to Thebes, Oedipus encounters an old man, and the two have a scuffle that then turns into a fight, and then he ends up killing the old man, because all Greek heroes have to kill people.
Random people, for no reason, like the cupbearer.
So after he kills this old man, I'm out. Let's hurry up to Thebes. So he hurries his way to Thebes. So Oedipus arrives in Thebes to a couple of different pieces of news. So Thebes is kingless. The king has been murdered. He's dead. He's gone. But Oedipus isn't really sad because, one, he doesn't know who the fuck the king of Thebes is, nor does he care. But what he really cares about is that there is a sphinx who has laid siege to Thebes because they no longer have a king. So, Oedipus, in order to actually enter the city of Thebes, has to pass through the area that the sphinx has claimed. So it's like a gate with the doors or whatever, and like the sphinx is like on top. You can't really see my hand. He's like on top. So a sphinx, for those who don't know, has the head of a human, the body of a lion, and the wings of an eagle. And it will pose a riddle to all who encounter it, and if you answer wrong, it eats you. And I'm sure a lot of people, when they hear sphinx, immediately think of ancient Egypt with the sphinx there. And the Greek sphinx and the Egyptian sphinx are actually almost identical, except that in Greece, it's a female, and in Egypt, it's a male. So that's the only difference. Otherwise, the whole myth of them is the same, all of that. So Oedipus puts on a brave face and is like, all right, let's do this. So he walks up to confront the sphinx, and the sphinx asks her riddle. Do you know what the riddle is, Titania?
Is the answer open sesame?
No. So I'm really shocked that you don't know this. This is probably, like, the sphinx and this particular riddle are like never
apart. I might have heard it. I just don't remember. So say
true.
It.
No. True. So the riddle is, which creature has one voice and yet becomes four-footed and two-footed and three-footed?
None.
And the answer is man, because you start off on 4 feet, then you grow and you're on 2 feet, and then when you get super old, you have a cane, so you have 3 feet. Man.
Did not know that one.
Oh, really? I'm shocked. Okay. So now my fun fact, fun story. No, I'm joking. Fun fact. So this riddle isn't actually told in the original myth. It's just kind of like left up to your imagination. This was just put in afterwards in later retellings. And another fun fact, there is a version of the story in which he has to answer a second riddle.
Well, that seems unfair. Is it if you answer the first riddle correctly, then they won't eat your top half, but if you answer the second riddle wrong, they'll eat your lower half? Like, why two?
Do you want to hear the second riddle, since yes. I know you're not going to get it? Okay, so the second riddle is, which I want you to answer this, because I'm really interested to see what you say. So, there are two sisters. One gives birth to the other, and she, in turn, gives birth to the first. Who are the two sisters?
I expected that to go. I'm sorry. Who were they?
So there are two sisters. One gives birth to the other, and she, in turn, gives birth to the first. Who are the two sisters?
Sun and the moon?
You're so close! So the answer is day and night, though technically I feel it should be dawn and night, because in Greek mythology, the moon and the dawn are sisters, and it is Selene and Eos.
I'm going to give it to me. I think
Like I said, you came really close. Helios is the sun god who's later replaced by Apollo, so that's why it can't be like the sun and the moon. But yeah, you're pretty damn close. So anyways, Oedipus guesses correctly. Otherwise, this wouldn't be a story at all.
A story.
And the sphinx is slain. So how is the sphinx slain?
Yes! Escalated way back. Like, I'm going to ask you a couple riddles. Oh, you got them right. Dab.
So, you're really not that far off. So,
oh my goodness!
So, how the sphinx is killed differs depending on which version of the story you're telling. You know, they all have different versions and stuff. Most have the sphinx either throwing itself off the cliff to its death, or Oedipus stabbing it or beheading it or some other way and killing it. Because, like, its whole purpose was to prevent people from passing, so it's, like, it no longer has a job anymore.
Aww. But
my personal favorite version of how the Sphinx dies is that it eats itself.
Like the snake?
No. So it, like, literally just, like, turns around on itself and just, like, eats itself.
It makes me sad. Also, I just want to keep pointing out how horrifying it is to keep remembering that it has a human mouth.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is like Attack on Titan level creepiness.
So yeah, that's how the Sphinx is slain. So Oedipus enters Thebes and he's given a hero's welcome because he ridded the town of the Sphinx. And they're like, well, shit, you might as well be our king. And he's like, fuck yeah, I'll be king. Why wouldn't I? See, he becomes king.
Where this is going.
Right. So he gets to marry the widow queen and he reigns beautifully with her. Like, they are a fantastic royal couple. Madly in love. They have several children. Years go by. And then Thebes that was prospering. So, like, they've, like, made it up the tower. Sharp decline. They are now being tormented by a plague.
I know why the Disney movie Hercules chose Thebes, where the Hydra was at, and, like, the whole place was run down, is because this shit just keeps happening all the time.
So, yeah, Thebes gets the shit in. Okay, I can't even say that because technically Troy gets the shit end of the stick.
But in the end, yes. In
as a close second. Like, nothing bad ever happens in Sparta because...
Well, minus the whole, you know, 300 thing, but sure. But that wasn't technically in Sparta.
Also, it... Anyways.
Not that's... the movie, the actual battle.
I was saying, and that's a story for another time, because of that movie, everyone's like, oh my god, this is what it was. No, that's not how it actually happened. Anyway. So, plague. So Oedipus decides to seek out an oracle, not the oracle, just a oracle. And he asks how he can rid the kingdom of this plague. And his cure, as we all know when oracles say, this is how you cure it, it doesn't really make much sense. But his cure is that he has to find the killer of the previous king, and that's how he'll cure Thebes of this plague.
Suicide.
It's so easy, right?
I mean, like, obviously, you're having a problem. Don't do that, no. Remember, call the helpline. What is it, 1-800?
Get help or whatever. Get help, I don't know.
You're having thoughts. Don't listen to the oracle.
No, you have to find the person who killed the previous king. So the person who killed the king that died before he arrived. That's what he has to do. I'm like... Didn't the last time we have this happen was in Hercules and he had to, like, turn himself into a slave for 12 years or some shit, which was how he cured his disease? Greeks and their diseases, man. So he starts his shirt. He starts his search. And stumbles upon a bombshell. The previous king was King Laius. And the king was slain by a random person on the road leading to Thebes, who Oedipus then finds out, second bombshell, was him. So he's the one who killed the previous king.
What?
And then he brings the news to his wife, and he gets another bombshell, because his wife is Jocasta, and Jocasta and Laius are his actual parents. And the prophecy happened just as he was told. He killed his father and married and loved his mother. Now,
prophecy.
I'm sure there is a question somewhere of how the fuck does he find all this out? And the answer is magic. They just do. Like, he literally learns that he is adopted. Jocasta learns that a shepherd saved her first son, gave him to this couple. And obviously that has to be Oedipus because how many orphans get adopted? It's boom, wham, done.
Just saying, it was a self-fulfilling prophecy. Had they raised their own son, it probably wouldn't happen.
Well, you can't change the fates. You can't change what they've already set in motion.
Well, then Ooh, then maybe he would have been a really evil person, murdered his father, and just like took his mother. Oh. At least this
So,
way he's kind of victim.
yeah, so Queen Jocasta, after learning this news, hangs herself. Just abrupt, hangs herself. It gets better. So then Oedipus, with this knowledge and after seeing his mother slash wife kill herself, plucks out his own eyes so that he will never again be able to see and lives out the rest of his days like this.
That sounds familiar. Was that in
Fun
one of the
story,
plays?
right? Yeah, fun story. And that's the tale of Oedipus.
What
All
is the lesson to be learned here? Because a lot of myths have lessons, and that's.
the lesson is that you can't cheat fate. Straight up. That is actually the lesson of pretty much all of these stories I'm about to tell you. You can't cheat fate. Actually, not Narcissus, but our next story, Orpheus, is that you can't cheat fate. That's the other part of it. So
Okay.
anyway, fun story. So story number two is the tale of Orpheus and Eurydice, is how I've always heard it pronounced, so that's how I'm going to say it. But I feel like they pronounce it differently in the video game Hades. I think they say something different. But Eurydice is how I've always heard it pronounced. It's a dead language, no one fucking cares. So so you might want to have some tissues ready. I didn't ask if you had tissues because this is actually kind of a sad story. Will work. Do
My cat
I
was sleeping on them.
have to get to I'm gonna need tissues. Hold on. Partly for my nose, partly because I'm a big baby, and this is actually like a really sad fucking story.
Here's how I'll dab my tears.
Anyways, so Orpheus is the child of the god Apollo and the muse Calliope. So Calliope is the muse of epic poetry, and she's kind of like the head of the muses. So if you think back to Hercules, she's the one. Yeah. Yep. So unlike his big daddy Zeus, Apollo is actually a really loving father and showers all of his children with not only his own talents, but like gifts specially made for them. So he makes sure that they know how to do like everything. Great guy. Love Apollo, even if he's a shit person. Anyways.
He's trying.
Yeah. He goes through a lot of shit in his life, okay? So Apollo gives a lyre to Orpheus and teaches him how to play it. And just like his dad, Orpheus is amazing at it. And not just amazing, it is said that when he plays, the sound was so beautiful that everything stopped and listened. Everything. Trees, mountains, water, everything stopped so that they could listen to him play. So I feel like he's like better than his dad at playing the lyre. I'm just saying. So Orpheus meets the beautiful Eurydice, and the two fall madly in love and are married. And they're the perfect couple. And I don't mean this in like a they're perfect on the outside, but at home it was like a whole other story. Like they truly, deeply loved and cherished each other, and they were the epitome of a loving relationship. And
Aww.
that is until they weren't.
I was gonna say,
So
end story, right there. Leave it.
oh, my nose is running. So, when they were married, Hymen, I know it's an unfortunate name, but Hymen, the god of marriage and the brother of Orpheus, told them that their love would not last. So, if you
Rude.
remember, Hera is also the goddess of marriage. So, Hymen isn't technically the god of marriage, he's the god of weddings. So he would always be invited to the wedding to like if he wasn't invited, your love was like doomed from the start. So Hera, goddess of wedding of marriage, Hymen is the god of weddings. Kind of the same thing, but not really. I don't know. So he tells them that their love would not last, and Apollo, as a god of many, many, many things, often passes some of these gifts in more than one way on to his children.
So the big three of his gifts are the gift of music, the gift of medicine and healing, and the gift of prophecy. So Hymen is a child of Apollo, and he has the gift of foresight. So he foresees tragedy for this couple in the future, and he wants to warn his brother, but you can't fight fate.
That's also rude. Just saying.
So Eurydice loved to dance, and one day she went out into the woods to dance with the nymphs, or naiads, depending on which version you are. Naiads are a type of nymph that represent water, so they're water nymphs, naiads. So there are a couple different versions of what happens in the forest. The short version is that she was just dancing. The long version is that there was a shepherd in this forest who spots her, and he falls in love with her. So he chases her down because he wants to have sex with her, and she flees. So whichever version you go with, the end result is the same. Eurydice comes too close to a snake who bites her and kills her instantly.
Aww.
Yes.
Did not turn into a tree like I was hoping.
No, she does not. So when Orpheus comes to pick up his wife and return home, he finds her dead. So, grief-stricken, he begins to play a song so powerful and moving that all beings, dead, alive, mortal, gods, inanimate, animate, hear it and are moved by the sound, feeling his sorrow and grief and sharing in it. So, Orpheus tries to move past this grief, but as the days go by, he cannot. And he... I'm trying to read my notes and they don't make sense. I don't know what I was trying to say here, but it's not what actually happens, right? Okay. So he wants to see his wife and have her in his arms again. I don't know what the fuck I was trying to say. And this becomes so all-consuming and great that he makes the venture that most people only make once in their life, and that is the journey to Hades / the underworld. So mortals are not able to just, like, enter and exit the underworld whenever they please. It can be easy to find an entrance to the underworld. Like, they're not necessarily hidden because they don't really care who goes into the underworld, but they do care who leaves. Like, you're not supposed to leave even if you enter there unintentionally. So typically, in order to find one of these entrances, you do still need the help of a god or similar being to find one of the entrances. We see this a lot with a lot of our demigods actually needing help from other gods to enter. Mostly Hermes. Hermes is the big one because he travels back and forth. Excuse me. That was rude. Okay. So with the help of Hermes, Orpheus, names are hard, enters Hades and he finds Cerberus. And wouldn't you know, Cerberus is Orpheus's number one fan. So Orpheus is able to easily pass by the hound by playing a song for him. But I like to imagine that he plays the song and Orpheus plays the song, Cerberus lays down on his back and then asks for stomach pats or scratches, and Orpheus obliges, and that's how he gets passed. Because it's just, Cerberus is just a big dog.
A good boy.
He is a good boy. So he travels to the home of the king and queen of the underworld, his aunt and uncle, Persephone and Hades. And he presents himself before them, and he plays his lyre so that he can tell them the tale of Eurydice and his only wish to be with her again. So, as I've said before, Hades is like the CEO of the underworld, and unfortunately, he's really good at his job. So he doesn't just let people leave once they enter, unfortunately. But Persephone is a little bit different, and she is so moved by the story of their love that she actually sides with Orpheus and asks her husband to find some sort of compromise to let them be together again. Instead of just killing Orpheus, like would make sense, they do this instead. So Hades agrees to let Orpheus take Eurydice back to the world of the living on one condition. He is not allowed to look at Eurydice until they have completely exited the underworld and have made it into the sun. Yes, I know, I'm pretty sure all of these stories are from Metamorphosis by Ovid, but that's okay. So if you've seen the play or read the story, these all sound really familiar.
Is this also a Bible story?
No. I don't believe so. But it's funny that you say that, because in the other one that I read up, there's one that's very Bible story heavy. But I mean, we all know that a lot of these stories like intermix with, like, they have the Great Deluge and stuff like that, which is the Great Flood.
Keep going.
You think what?
Keep going. I want to see if I'm right.
I have no idea. So Orpheus agrees to the simple task because he's like, I'm patient enough, I can wait until we make it to the outside world. So the task is set by Hades, and it's seen by some as a ploy, because Hades knows that Orpheus will not be able to resist seeing his wife before he leaves, and therefore he's not concerned about her leaving. But I like to believe this, that the souls of the dead are not the same as they are in life, so they look vastly different, and Hades knows this. And he doesn't want Orpheus to see this side of Eurydice, and this is the sort of compromise that he makes to kind of save him that pain of seeing someone he loves in a vastly different state than he remembers. Now, don't get me wrong, Hades is not a fantastic guy, but he's definitely not the worst. And, like, I've covered a few stories, so, like, we kind of have an idea for him. I just haven't covered, like, the big three, or big one, I mean, which is kidnapping of Persephone. Anyways, so I almost did that for this. I considered it.
It would have been a good one.
It would have.
I would have stuck a Lore Olympus image as the cover.
I almost did it.
Why you're wrong.
I almost did it just because of that. But I didn't. It's okay. Maybe someday we'll get there. Probably not. Anyways. So Orpheus, agreeing to the terms, begins the trek back to the sun, and he just assumes that Eurydice is following behind him because it's kind of like the arrangement. So he starts ascending, because I like the way that it's kind of described. It seems like he has to like walk up these like really long hallway of stairs that just seems like never ending until he reaches the sun, and that's the outside world. I don't know if that's true or not, that's just how I've always imagined it. So as he starts to ascend, he kind of starts to question if she's actually following behind him. And the reason for this is because he doesn't hear anyone behind him. So he doesn't hear anyone breathing, he doesn't hear any footsteps, he doesn't hear anyone talking, it's just him. And he's kind of worried, because what if she isn't following him and maybe like got lost along the way? Or what if Hades lied to him and isn't actually planning to let her go at all? So these thoughts start to like plague his mind. And as he makes his way to the exit, he tries his best to, like, banish them. And I imagine it's probably similar to what Pandora had to go through, listening to the voices constantly berating her. So he tries to reason with himself. He's like, Hades won't lie about this. Like, he's my uncle. He's true to his word. If nothing else, like, he is the god of the underworld. Like, this is what he does. But the closer he gets to the exit, the harder it becomes. Like, he eventually makes it up like this long staircase and sees the like entrance to the outside world, and he, like, see the sun and everything. And when he sees the sun, he just has a full-on panic attack, because he cannot hear anything but himself, and he cannot resist looking behind to see if she is there. So he is steps away from their freedom, and Orpheus looks behind him. And he sees Eurydice, his wife, right behind him, just as Hades had promised. And the shade of Eurydice cries out for Orpheus, because she is suddenly yanked back to the underworld, and she will never be able to leave again because the deal is broken. You get one chance. One opportunity.
Everything you ever wanted. Would you capture it or look behind you?
Or let it slip. He's obviously going to let it slip. So Orpheus attempts to follow, but he finds himself unable to, like, descend the stairs again. So being only mortal, you really should only ever be able to enter the underworld once. He's already made that journey. Technically, he's going to make it again later, but it is what it is. So
Once again, he spirals into a pit of despair and plays his lyre, and his mournful song starts calling for death. So instead of being happy and full of love, he's just singing about death. Because in death, he will be able to see his Eurydice again. And so he starts like walking while he's playing, and he's like looking for someone or something, if you will, to kill him. And he finds his end at the claws of a beast. But this death is not what he was looking for, because his mother and the other muses take his head and keep it among the living so that he could continue to sing forever, which forever bars him from entering the underworld and seeing his love again.
His mother?
Yes, his mother.
That is evil and cruel and awful. Like,
he was a better musician than Apollo, and they did not want that to go to the underworld, so they held on to it.
You know, he's probably begging all the time, like, just let me go. Oh, that's awful. I don't like that one.
Yep, so that's my number two tragic love story. It's probably one of my favorites of all time. Probably the first one would be one that I was going to cover but didn't. And then the only other one that probably might come before this is the story of Isis and Osiris.
The reason why I thought that one was a Bible story, so I looked it up so I knew what I was talking about, because not gonna lie, I'm not super like I know the gist of stories, but I'm not like, yes, this is absolutely what happened in the Bible. Right. So it's Lot's wife that I was thinking of, and they're in Sodom, and you know, in ancient Bible land, Sodom is a very like sinful place.
Yeah.
And God was going, if I remember correctly, like I only have a synopsis here, but if I remember correctly, God was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, and these people lived there and they wanted to get out. And so he was told, I guess by God, to take his wife and daughters and leave the city. But they cannot turn around and look back. And so they're running, and his wife falls behind him, and he can't hear her. So he turns to look. And as soon as he sees her, she turns to a pillar of salt.
Oh, wow. I literally don't remember this story at all. Like, I know about Sodom and Gomorrah, but I don't remember that part at all. Wow.
Yeah, I'm looking, like, they have the whole... Yeah, Sodom and Gomorrah destroyed. Two angels met Lot as he sat at the gate of Sodom and offered them lodging. They refused because they desired to be in the street all night.
Aww.
And then the angels pulled Lot aside and said, and locked the door. No one would listen to because God said, oh, so apparently God told Lot that he was going to destroy the city, and Lot was trying to warn his sons-in-law, but they were mocking him and refused. And as the dawn was approaching, the angels again told Lot that judgment was immediate and he needed to take his wife and daughters out of the city. As they fled, one of the angels said, flee for your lives, don't look back, and don't stop anywhere in the plain. Flee to the mountains or you'll be swept away. And then, like, literally, Sodom is being destroyed by, like, meteors. That's the description. And it's his wife that looked back. He didn't look back. So his wife looked back and she became a pillar of salt. That's what it was.
Oh, okay. Because she's the one who looked back. So she's the one who got...
She disobeyed.
Salt whammied.
And that's Genesis. So, you know, when God is at his most wrathful.
Yeah. So,
that's why I was like, this sounds very familiar to the Bible story about the lady. I always thought it was the guy that turned around, which is why I was like, this is weird.
It's okay.
There's your Bible lesson for the day.
Yeah.
Friendly neighborhood Catholic.
So, moral for Orpheus and Eurydice, you can't cheat fate, obviously.
Also, you'd be completely screwed over by your own mother.
Yeah. I mean, the gods and the muses, because they're born of the gods, are no exception to the rule of really shitty people. So
yeah, we all know they're pretty much all bad parents, so like what's one more?
True,
true. I think Apollo's probably the best one in terms of parenting. Like, but...
Because he actually took care of his children.
Yeah. Like, several of his sons, like, become, like... They don't call them doctors, but basically, like, he teaches them and gives them the gift of medicine, and they become, like, able to, like, cure plagues and shit. Like, he does a lot.
He could have just thrown them out and let them fend for themselves. No.
Yeah. I mean, like, he also, like, rapes and curses a lot of people, too, but, you know.
Daphne and Cassandra. Anyways.
So, the next one is...
Yes.
Narcissist. So I guess it's tune out now. My little summary earlier is all you need to know.
Yes. Because buckle up, bitches. This is going to be intense. For more than one reason. So yes, if suicide at all bothers you, or if you feel any particular way about the suicide of a gay person, please tune out now. Okay. All right. So, I had to give, like, that little break, you know, so that people can, like, exit. They're not like, oh, my God, let me exit. You know what I mean? So, anyways. So, Narcissus. So, Narcissus is the son of the River Gar. This is going to be a long one. I'm sorry. The River God. Oh, my God. Hold on.
Is this the guy from the movie Hercules that has Meg?
That has the mirror? Yes.
No, that has Meg.
Meg. Ooh.
I know there's a god in there that definitely has the mirror.
Yeah, that's... And that's
the river god you're talking about. Is it the horse guy? They're at the water, and she's like, I'm a damsel, and I'm in distress. I can handle it. Have a nice day.
I'm looking it up because I don't actually know what the name of the god is in Hercules. No, that is Achilleos? Achilleos.
Okay.
Is that one. Who is a god of a river, but it's specifically the river that he inhabits, which is a common theme in Greek. So no, this is the river god. I apologize. This name is intense and intimidating. I had it before I started getting ready to say it, and now, okay. Cephisus. Cephisus.
We can just call him Sissy.
No, because that's Sisyphus. Which, this is not Sisyphus. That's a whole other story.
It sounds like you're saying the same thing.
I know.
Sisyphus?
Sisyphus. Siffy. Okay. River god Siffy and the naiad named Liriope. Liriope. Pay. That's how they pronounce their E's at the end of words. Thank you very much. That's your Greek lesson for the day.
Yeah, I have the hardest time when I see the ends of the E, or the ends. The E's at the end of words, of names, and I always stop. Like, was it Calliope? I'm like, Calliope.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, see, you do, yours is with the E's, mine is with the S's. When it has S's at the end of a name, and again, like, most of these are not ones that we've heard, like, actually said, so it's just looking at it and trying to guess how it's said. Siffy. All right, so anyways, so Siffy and a naiad named Liriope gave birth to Narcissus. So he is a hunter of great renown for both his abilities as a hunter and his dashing good looks. So his beauty was said to rival that of any other, and I'm sure that some probably said that it rivaled that of the gods, probably namely the goddess Aphrodite, who is the goddess of beauty. But as he grew up, his beauty also grew, and soon enough, he was always surrounded by crowds of people who were professing their love for him. Now, Narcissus was many things, but he was not humble and he was not nice. In fact, he's a fucking asshole. So.
There's the Narcissus, being a narcissist, it's actually fitting.
Yes.
This one.
it, way more than any other ones have ever been, more than like an Oedipus complex, more than Napoleon complex, like being a like when we finish the story, there's a reason why it's reserved for very specific people. So every time that someone would confess to him, he would just simply be like, of course you're in love with me, how could you not be? And then that was the end of it. Like, he ignored all their advances, every single one of them. So because of this, he had very few friends and even less companions. But he did manage to keep one friend, and his name was Aminius. So Aminius was convinced that while Narcissus couldn't love random people, he could definitely come to love maybe a friend of his. So he stayed by his side and fell more and more in love with him the longer he stayed with him. So Narcissus kept Aminius at his side because he liked reveling in the attention that Aminius would lavish on him, and he enjoyed how the young man helped him kind of get rid of his would-be suitors. So, like, it was very easy for Aminius to step in and be like, okay, you've had your fun, you've looked at him, you've touched him, let's move on. So for Narcissus, he was kind of like less of a friend or a potential lover, and more of like that groupie that kind of followed him around and would get rid of crowds and stuff, you know, that type of person. So Narcissus had never experienced love, so he had no idea what it would mean to lose that love or to like have it thrown back at you in a cruel joke, which will kind of come to bite him in the ass. So one night, Narcissus and Aminius stop at an inn to rest, and as always, they share a room because it's cheaper that way, I guess. I don't know how much a room was in ancient Greece. So instantly they're swarmed by tons of people. So it's like suitors and people who are just trying to get a glimpse at him. I imagine it's like the scene in Hercules when all the fans come and like swarm on him, and then she's like, I got a sweatband. That's what I like to imagine. Okay. Everywhere that goes is what happens to Narcissus. And as usual, Narcissus is just like, yes, of course you love me now. Be gone. Peasants, go look at me from afar. I don't want you near me. So when they are finally alone, Aminius works up the courage to confess his love. And his name, okay, now I know why Tolkien always said the bow of Legolas instead of Legolas's, because let me tell you, just saying Narcissus is hard. All right, so Narcissus simply smiled. That was a lot of S's. Simply smiled at him, and he tells him the same thing that he tells everybody else. Of course you are in love with me. How could you not be? This is me we're talking about. And Aminius is hurt, but he's like, he just thinks that I'm one of these other people. Like, he doesn't think that I truly love him. So he doesn't back down. He's like, we're friends. We've been friends for forever. I've loved you all this time. I've watched you send away everyone else but me, but you treat me the same. How can you truly feel nothing for me? And Narcissus tells him that, no, I really don't feel anything for you, but thanks for your love. Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. So Aminius is angry, obviously, and he tells Narcissus that the only person he loves is himself, and Narcissus thinks about it for a moment and agrees, because until that moment he hadn't realized that of course he loves himself, because who else was as great and beautiful? And the answer was no one. So it made sense for him to love himself. But Narcissus has had enough of Aminius and his love confession, if you will. So he tells him that he needs to go if he can't accept the fact that Narcissus will never love him. And Aminius doesn't want to leave, but Narcissus kind of forces him to leave because he doesn't want to be around him anymore. So Aminius goes to leave the room, and as he's leaving, he tells Narcissus that he will come to regret all of the hurt that he has caused, and along the way, like, picks up the sword of Narcissus. So I don't want to say Narcissus's.
Narcissus's sword.
The sword of Narcissus. And he exits the room, closes the the door, so he's like alone in the hallway, and Aminius demands that the gods take notice and punish Narcissus, and then tearfully plunges the sword into himself and kills himself at the doorway, so that Narcissus has to face what he has caused in the morning when he opens up the door.
Aww.
I know, it's kind of, I told you, this is a little bit intense. So, Aminius's pleas does reach the gods, and in particular, one god, who I'm so happy to bring on this channel, and that is the goddess Nemesis. So, I'm going to try my best to explain her, because she's kind of a tricky god, and I feel like everyone has this image of what she actually does, and it's not quite what she does. So, the word nemesis is what we use when we're talking about, like, a rival, like your arch nemesis. Right. But for the Greeks, it's like a little bit more order related. So she helps keep the balance between happiness and unhappiness with her sister, Tike, who is the goddess of fortune. So Tyche. it's T-Y-C-H-E, okay? But it's Psyche, but with a T. Anyways, Tyche. So she would be the happiness, whereas Nemesis would be the unhappiness. So it doesn't necessarily mean, like, anything evil or covert or anything like that, but that is what it is. So she's like an avenging goddess, if you would. So when you are wanting to invoke a god to help you correct a mistake, or if you feel like you've been wronged, you are calling on Nemesis. And she is also the goddess who would punish people who had, like, ridiculously good luck,
yeah,
or who had committed evil deeds. So she would be the one who, like, it doesn't happen that way, but, like, let's say during the Trojan War, she got really pissed off because Achilles was just that good of a fighter. She could potentially have been a goddess that you would have invoked to stop him because, like, he's unbeatable and she doesn't like that. Like, you can't have that. So anyways, that's Nemesis. So Nemesis catches wind of this plea from Aminius and sets her sights on Narcissus, the beautiful hunter. And the moment that this happens, he is doomed. You don't want to ever be in the path of Nemesis. So, when Narcissus... What?
Sounds like my kind of lady.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. She's beautiful. So, when Narcissus awakes, he opens up the door and finds the dead body of Aminius. And he just doesn't care. He literally
Oh, what's this doing here?
Yeah. He literally just, like, steps over him and then, like, shuts the door and goes along his way. Because to him, Aminius was a coward who took his own life because he couldn't handle rejection. So, yeah. So he decides, whatever, I'm just going to go off into the forest and go hunting because that's what I do best, other than look great. So, while Narcissus is on his way to the forest, we have another story happening at the same time. So we're going to kind of pause with Narcissus on the way to the forest and hop over to this other story. Because you see, Zeusy, he really, 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 really likes to have sex.
Yes, he does.
But he doesn't want it with just one person. So he quite often makes trips from Mount Olympus to visit people and sleep with them in any and all forms he can possibly take on. Yep. So on this particular day, Zeus is enjoying the day in the forest with some nymphs. And while he's messing around with them, a couple of them hear a noise and they're like, oh, oh shit, is that Hera? Does Hera come? Did Hera find us? Right? Because as we all know, Hera does not like Zeus being with anybody else other than her. And she kind of takes her anger out on the other party, like with Hercules. So, terrified, the nymphs and the youngest of their group, Echo, to distract Hera, allowing them to escape. Zeus included. So he gets away scot-free for being a dick. So Echo goes searching for the queen goddess and she finds her. And she kind of tries to, like, play it off as a happy coincidence. Like, oh my god, Hera, you're here too. It's so nice yada, yada, yada. And Hera is like, Eureka, my husband. Sorry, not sorry. Yeah. So she starts like yelling at her and asking questions like, where is Zeus? What's going on? Where is he? Did you sleep with him? Like all of that, just rapid fire questions. And the young nymph plays dumb. And she just kind of like starts repeating back the questions like, is Zeus here? You know, did he sleep with us? Just kind of,
oh
like,
my gosh, Zeus who?
Yeah, not my nose. So she's like not wanting to answer these questions. She doesn't want to get caught in a lie. So she just keeps repeating the questions back to her. And Hera doesn't like this. So Hera, in her rage, curses Echo, as we all know what an echo is. So the curse is something along the lines of, you will never be able to talk unless someone else does, and you will only be able to say the last thing spoken to you. Curse in place, Hera leaps, because I guess she's going to go find Zeus on her own, or she like hears a little bell go off that announces that Zeus is back at Mount Olympus. I don't know how she knows where he is at all times, but Hera seems to know. She's got GPS on his dick, I guess. I don't know.
Something's moving. Better go. Right.
So Echo returns to her sisters, and they're like super glad that she's okay and Hera didn't smite her where she stood. And they're like, thank you for saving us. You let us get away. Zeus is fine. Yada, yada, yada. But all Echo does is thank them back. She's like, yeah, thank you. And they're like, no. We didn't do anything. You did it all. And Echo replies by just repeating the last words. And to her horror, she realizes the full extent of the curse that Hera has placed on her, and that she cannot tell anyone that this is what happened. So she's stuck.
And her sisters just think she's being annoying, because she's the baby of the group, and that's what the babies do.
Kind of, but not really. So realizing that this is what the curse is, she actually runs away from her sisters. So she flees. And she starts running through the forest until she runs into a young hunter. Literally. Like, wham! I assume she, like, turns around a tree and he's, like, right there and it's like, boom. Because I don't know how else you're going to literally run into someone in a forest. I don't know.
Well, he's hunting. He's being very quiet.
He's also a nymph, though. Like, you would think that she would have some sort of, I don't know. I just assume she turns a tree and he's right there. You know, instead of turning a corner, she turns a tree, bam, right into him. Runs face first into the chest of the beautiful hunter and instantly falls in love. And we all know who it is. It's Narcissus. Spoiler alert. So Narcissus asks if she's all right, and she merely repeats the question, are you all right? So he asks for her name, and she asks for his. So he tells her, and then she just repeats it. So he's like, yeah, my name's Narcissus. And she's like, Narcissus. So the more that Narcissus says or asks, the more things she starts to repeat. And at first he's kind of flattered, you know, because she's just like asking questions about him, you know, getting him to talk about himself and saying his name 50,000 times. And then it gets to the point where it's kind of annoying. And so soon enough, he starts, like, demanding that she leave him alone, and all she can do is repeat, leave me alone. I feel so bad for Echo, really do. Yeah. So when he goes to leave, Echo follows, because she's scared and in love, and really just wants him to love her and be loved by him. I don't know why this is suddenly her infatuation, but here we are. Greek myths.
This is why it's a Cupid's arrow thing. It's an immediate in love, like, there's no build up, it's just bam.
If we would have done the other episode, I was actually going to talk about Cupid.
Oh no. You're mighty.
You're the one who picked this. It's all your fault. Not gonna hear about the story of Cupid for a while now. All right, anyways, so Narcissus obviously doesn't love her and sends her away. I assume he like hits her or something. Whatever he does makes her realize that she can't be around him, and she leaves. So she leaves crying and internally, because she can't actually speak, cursing Narcissus to the gods, and then just like starts wandering the forest. And all she can do is repeat the noises that she hears until her body literally like eats itself away, and the only thing that's left is her voice.
Aww.
It's pretty quick progression.
Yeah, apparently.
So Echo's curse that she had kind of put on Narcissus reaches the ears of the one and only Nemesis, who's already been watching closely what Narcissus does. And so then when she hears this second plea, she's like, boom, baby, it's my turn. So as Narcissus is walking through the forest, he comes upon this lake and he kneels down so he can take a drink and like refresh himself. And of course he sees his reflection before he like scoops up the water. And in that moment, Nemesis strikes him and makes him fall in love with himself. And he becomes so enamored with his own reflection that he finds himself in love and unable to look away. And so he stays there watching the reflection in the water until he also wastes away. So later, Echo's sisters are looking for her and they come across the body of Narcissus. And so they turn him into a flower so that they can forever preserve his beauty. And that's where the Narcissus flower comes from.
That's half right.
Yeah. I was like, you weren't too far off, but yeah. So yeah, three depressing, fucked up stories about love from Greek myths.
But like, did they ever find Echo?
Nope. All they had was her voice, and they never found her.
Those are good stories in Tragic Love Month.
Yeah. Let me tell you, my other set, there were six stories, and I think that they were even better. Plus, it also covered one of my all-time favorites that I don't want to mention because I don't want to spoil it, but anyways. So yeah, they're kind of my tragic, beautiful, not necessarily fucked up stories, but...
They're kind of fucked up. Like, in the grand scheme of things, they're kind of fucked up.
Yeah. I think, like, they're mild in terms of, like, what we've discussed on this channel.
There was no cannibalism, it's true.
I mean, the Sphinx eats itself? Does that count? Do animals eating themselves count as cannibalism, or is it only humans that can be considered cannibals? See, I don't understand how this cannibal thing works. We need to do an episode about cannibalism.
There's a lot of holes involved.
Exactly! Like, I need to know the specifics. Yeah. So that's kind of my thing. Love isn't really my thing, so this is
love is.
How I... What?
Tragic love is.
Yeah.
So that's three tragic love tales from Enkidu, which was very sad, and I'm going to have nightmares tonight now because
of the Sphinx eating itself.
Yes, because the human mouth thing of the Sphinx eating other human parts, or then eating the lion part. I don't know. It just
The face. It's just the head that's human. The rest of the body is a lion, and then it has.
Right. But you have a human mouth with like flat little teeth. Eating live creatures. Like, I don't know.
So bad.
My mouth eating another human if they fail the riddle freaks me out.
I'm so glad that I could actually come up with something really fucked up in these three stories. And it's not even about the stories. It's just the Sphinx.
So next month we'll be starting March, and this is our most anticipated month in my opinion because it is fucked up fables, fucked up month, yay!
I'm gonna die of alcohol poisoning. Next week's episode is mine, and I'm doing our Lord and Savior Dionysus.
So we will be diving into some wine in celebration.
Bacchanalia, bitches, let's do it!
Yeah, and we are going to do the episode drunk, not to be confused with the last episode, Phantom Part 2, where we were also drunk.
Accidentally
bad
drunk.
Day when we recorded.
Yeah, that was accidentally drunk. This is purposefully drunk.
Right. And we're not sure how far we're going to push ourselves, are we?
I don't work next weekend, so I can go a little bit more. Oh, God. I hope I don't puke on camera.
I promise you, if you puke on camera, I will cut it out. I will edit sober. Though it's kind of tempting to edit drunk.
I mean, I did the entire script writing for my episode while I was like a glass deep in wine, so it's gonna be a hot mess.
Yeah. So I'm really excited because I don't know the story very well, and I'm going to go and buy lots of sake of various flavors. So that's my wine, my rice wine. And maybe I'll also get some like red, I don't know, Dionysus feels like a red wine guy. So maybe I'll do that.
I learned way too much about wine looking up a fitting wine and then realized that it's not a wine I would enjoy. So I went with a different one.
Yeah. Fruity and delicious. So make sure to tune in next week because it's going to be stupid and fun. And I don't know why we decided to do this. We did.
Vi, he's a terrible influence on us.
It was Vi, and then she abandoned us. Vi, I believe that you return for at least one episode of Fucked Up Month.
Yeah, exactly.
Also, I'm going to do a little plug. I mentioned it earlier, but I'm not sure if that part was going to get edited out because I can't remember what was around it. But we are going to be launching a second podcast / YouTube channel called That Didn't Happen, centered around history. And I like the idea of comparing like recent pulp culture things like The Great or Six against the real story, but we're all going to do it differently. It'll be fun.
It's more like tackling the myths of history because it didn't actually happen.
And that's why I'm kind of like, I personally am stuck on a lot of pulp culture things because I read, if you've ever seen the musical Six, which is about King Henry VIII's Lives, I was reading comments on the bootleg version because, you know, can't go to Broadway right now. And there were lots of people in there saying things like, I can totally use this for my history paper, or why wasn't this around before my test? And I'm going, no.
Not how it actually happened, guys.
Yeah, I mean, it's cute, and it's got some points, but yeah, I was just like, no. And so we were talking, and I'm like, well, let's also do history. It just doesn't fit into fucked up fable.
Yeah.
It's called That Didn't Happen. You can find it on YouTube right now. There's nothing on there yet. But there will be soon.
Hopefully, maybe next month. Maybe in March we'll try and put out an episode. Get it started.
We record before we're drunk?
Yes.
Tune in next time.
Yeah. We're already there.
That's true. So, yeah. Bye.